Hello everybody, I'm Ekaterina Gavrilova, and today I would like to talk about SAP S/4HANA Cloud SDK product, which is currently beta and will be announced on TechEd, but we can take a look at some capabilities of the tool already now. And so a couple of words about myself. First of all, I started to work at SAP 10 years ago, firstly as a consultant in the area of financials for the ERP system. And later, so it was in Moscow back then. Then I moved to Germany and moved to development and product management, mainly in the cloud, so for cloud extensions for SAP S/4HANA. And the product that we are currently working on with our team in Potsdam in Innovation Center is called SAP S/4HANA Cloud SDK that I'm actually presenting now. So I do have a disclaimer here. But first, let's start with something exciting in this talk, because it's important. So first of all, the question, who works with this day in the day-to-day business, so to say? So who feels at home there, so to say? Yeah, okay, not that many. Actually, I'm surprised because I saw so many ABAP developers in the group here. Well, we probably all know that this is SAP GUI, which is a well-known interface for SAP ERP system. And probably we can compare our SAP ERP system with this kind of car. So why? It's very stable, it's reliable, you know that you reach your goal, so you can drive your business with this system very well. But for those who work with the system for a long time, and maybe not for that long time, you probably agree with me that you need some kind of skill to drive it. So it can be tricky, it's nice, but it can be tricky. So time goes by and SAP introduces the new version of SAP ERP system, which is also well known, and this is interface to this system, Fiori, and this is S/4HANA system, S/4HANA version of SAP ERP. What does it bring? On the one hand side, it's advanced user experience with Fiori, interfaces to reporting, to Fiori interfaces to creating the data, and so on. On the other hand side, it's also more performant, as because of, for example, SAP HANA underneath. So maybe we can compare the system with this kind of car. By the way, sorry for those who prefer Audi or something like this, so it was the only free picture that I found, quite nice. Right, so this is our SAP S/4HANA. You can own a nice car, but in this case, you of course need to maintain the software by the hardware by yourself as well. So what else SAP introduces for business management or for traveling in this world is SAP S/4HANA Cloud. So you share the system with other travelers, you pay just for the tickets, so to say, and you travel to some destination. So you manage your business with the help of SAP S/4HANA Cloud. But of course, SAP has many, many customers who want to travel to different destinations, who need some kind of adaptations for this system. Therefore, actually, SAP and some partners build cloud extensions for SAP S/4HANA or autonomous business applications in the cloud. Then probably can be, maybe you know some of them already. This application, for example, was built at SAP in Innovation Center, Financial Statement Insight. It's actually a cloud-native application that consumes data from SAP S/4HANA. It also builds some additional data model and logic on top. Another example of such app that I will also demo later is SAP RealSpend, which is also cloud-native, developed in Java, and SAP UI5 as a front-end, which also kind of runs autonomously in the cloud and consumes the data from S/4HANA. So this kind of system can be compared with small airplanes. They're quite lightweight, run autonomously, but still has the principles of S/4HANA. So what do we want to achieve next? So we cannot build that many applications if we don't have a standard process, if we don't have a standard tooling. And this is, so we want to actually build many of these planes, so to say. And to achieve this, we have built this kind of framework or this kind of factory that we want to provide for internal SAP development and for external development, so that everybody can come by, take the tools that he or she needs to build the application, and go ahead with building their planes. So this kind of tool set, we call it SAP S/4HANA Cloud SDK. And this is what I would like to talk about now. Right, but before I move forward to what actually SAP S/4HANA Cloud SDK is, let us think a little bit about how we can extend SAP S/4HANA in general, what methodologies and what concepts can we have here. So this is the first point. Let me start with the following thing. In general, we have SAP application, and there are two different methods that we can use for the extension of SAP S/4HANA. One would be in app extensions, where you modify the ABAP system itself and you add fields directly in the CDS view, for example. Or you can also have side-by-side extension where you build some logic in the platform, independently on the service that is directly in the backend system, that is located in the backend system. So let's take step-by-step guide here. So what possible options are there? So the first one would be simple side-by-side extensibility with custom UI. What does it mean? You have the standard OData service, or CDS view exposed to the standard OData service, whitelisted OData service in the backend S/4HANA on-premise or S/4HANA cloud. And you can build UI application in the cloud that consumes the existing OData service. That would be a simple side-by-side extensibility with custom UI. So the only thing that you build here is the Fiori application, Fiori UI 5 application that consumes OData service. What could be an example here? So for example, we have some standard Fiori application that displays line items of the FI documents. So if you want to somehow introduce it in a graphical way to build some charts, you will probably need some additional Fiori application on top of this data. This is something that you can build using this approach. There is an additional need sometimes to expose some more data from the S/4HANA system. For example, you don't see some OData services available here. You build some kind of customer extension with additional data, maybe some kind of Z-based CDS view, and you want to consume this data in the cloud. In this case, you will introduce an additional OData service in the S/4HANA system. This will be side-by-side part of the extension. But on top of this, you build also Fiori application that consumes this new OData service that you introduced. And this part will be in the cloud. And this part is side-by-side extension, so to say. There is more advanced methods that you can use, more freestyle approach, so to say, when you consume existing services, but you also build some additional Java-based, for example, or JVM-based logic in the cloud with additional data model on the, also on the data model side, so additional tables that you introduce directly in the cloud that you probably also can consume in your Java-based application and expose as OData service. So you don't have to do this data modeling directly in the S/4HANA part, but also you can do this in the cloud directly. And on top of this, there is a UI that you can also develop with UI5. And the last option that I would like to talk about, you can combine these two options. So you can do in-app extensions, so additional OData services in the S/4HANA system, with additional application logic and data model in the cloud. This can be also combined. So when I talk about the SDK or SAP S/4HANA Cloud SDK that I would like to introduce today, actually we address these two advanced methods of extensions. This is exactly where we have the main pain point. We have this flexibility, but for this to manage this flexibility, we need some kind of guidance. How do I develop this application, for example, with a Java language in the cloud, what quality rules my application should fulfill, what patterns, what programming languages, and so on can I use? And for to answer this question, we introduce the SDK, which is built on top of the cloud platform and provides some kind of abstractions for developers that can be easily used to build apps. So let's move forward and take a look at what at the SDK directly. So again, moving back to the first slide, why do we need the SDK? So for the guys like me who started in ABAP, who started in SAP GUI, with a classical ERP system, and moving to Java world, I need some kind of guidance. How I learn Java, how I start with the developing application, which tools are there, what tutorials are there. And this is exactly the pain points that we want to address with the SDK. So the main three points that we noticed when we started to think about how we can help our community to develop cloud applications are listed here. So the first point is related to the Java development itself, or application development itself. When we take the developers who just learn in Java, who learn the cloud development, we want to make their life easier, to provide some kind of abstractions, to make the learning of the platform simpler. And this point we address with Java libraries that we provide with the SDK. We will deep dive a little bit what exactly is there, so what kind of components are included into the SDK and how they can really help the development. Another pain point or another aspect is not really related to the development itself, but more related to the support and continuous integration. Of course, when we move into the cloud, we know that the development cycle is getting faster and we need to deliver the software quite fast and to automatically test it and have continuous integration, continuous delivery pipeline in place in order to regularly ship the software. This is also the point that we want to address with the SDK. So we, for example, integrate pipeline as code into our project templates. And our idea is also to publish the corresponding pipelines as open source projects. So you can also take a look and learn a little bit how you can set up your Jenkins infrastructure if you want to deliver the software. Another point, also last but not least, is of course the community. So we already have a quite huge ABAP community at SAP in the partner community, but what we are aiming to is to engage the community to together develop the Java application, to learn from each other, to learn best practices. And here we're also happy customers of SAP community where we have serious tutorials regarding the SDK, how you can get started with the SDK, and we are happy to kind of get feedback from you there to answer questions, to get questions. This is how we are engaged in the community. Generally speaking, if you look in a little bit, so this high-level SDK architecture or high-level diagram, what SDK is, where it sits. So of course, we are sitting on top of the platform, and basically we are helping to consume the platform services easier. So when you take the different services of the platform, what you probably need there. So for example, if you build multi-tenant applications, you need access to what tenant I'm currently in, or what user is currently accessing the service. All these kind of things, you don't need to think about how I implement the access to tenant when I work with the cloud platform, because this is abstracted in the SDK. So you basically take the class tenant accessor and get the tenant from the corresponding method. So things like this. And of course, there are also another part of this. So you can expose the services with the help of the SDK classes also quite easily. So you can do like exposing of raw data or RESTful services using corresponding methods and exactly classes of the SDK. Right, so a little bit about the technical architecture. I will now just quickly give a short overview about the components that are there, and then we can also take a look at the examples in the source code where we can maybe identify some of them, so I will get back to this picture later. So there are two like main parts of the SDK that I would like to highlight. From the name of this component, you can already see this is four extensions of the SAP S/4HANA. So this is kind of our main focus. Because of course there are many services in the platform, but we are mainly focusing on this integration part. And this part of, or these blocks of the SDK are actually there to support this S/4HANA integration. So one of them is the ERP connectivity that allows to abstract the S/4HANA editions that is connect behind the scene. So you can, when you use SDK, you can identically connect SAP S/4HANA Cloud and SAP S/4HANA on-premise. you just use a corresponding object and use the method for connection. Also, we are talking to S4HANA, not directly to the tables, but using the protocols like OData for read of data and SOAP for communication with BAPI to write data back. This is also implemented using corresponding query builders for SOAP and for OData. In the application logic level, we have an additional capabilities to wrap your S4HANA calls into Hystrix commands. By this means, you can achieve also resilience of your application. So what actually Hystrix does, it allows to provide you some fallbacks or socket breakers in case of this backend system is unavailable, for example, which is actually crucial if you if you are building the multi-tenant or microservices system, also that is connecting to several third-party systems. So this is also included here. And in addition to this, we also have some cross-layer components that you see on the left-hand side. So here we have platform abstractions, which are quite important, as I mentioned before. So we actually support different versions of the platform here. And for the user of the SDK, this is quite transparent with which platform you communicate. I'm actually talking about SAP Cloud Platform here in both cases. It would be Neo or Cloud Foundry. And so we abstract different services of the platform so you can easily consume it using the SDK. There are some frameworks adaption, for example, for feature toggling or for Hystrix framework and for persistency. And as I also mentioned before, we are aiming to provide some best practices for a continuous integration pipelines. So we are providing Jenkins scripts for a pipeline and also some kind of testing and mocking for unit tests that you would you could use or you could build. So let me just quickly show you what is already available there. At the beginning, I mentioned that I'm talking now about the beta version of the product. And if you're interested, you can actually already get access to this system or to this product and download it actually now from Service Marketplace. You just need to accept corresponding test evaluation agreement and it should be available for you. In TechEd 2017, so actually in a few weeks or months, the general availability is planned to be announced. So it will be then available in public repositories like Maven and GitHub. So let me just quickly go to the S4HANA Cloud SDK page where I can show you some materials that are available there. So this is our main page. There are some technical details regarding the feature overview where maybe you can get some more insight on the topics that I was just talking about. But maybe the most interesting part is in the community where we have a series of blogs regarding how you can basically get started with the SDK. And I would highly recommend to take a look at this overview blog, which actually references a step-by-step tutorial how you can get started with building your cloud application. So we, like with intention, we built the tutorial in such a way so you can start with the basics, like how do you install your development infrastructure, for example, locally with IDE, like Eclipse, IntelliJ, with Maven, how you install the SDK currently in beta. In GA, it will be slightly different. We will adapt the tutorials correspondingly. And then how you build your first Hello World application with the SDK or two versions of the platform. Starting from the Hello World, we are moving to communication with S4HANA, building the example of how you can call actually cost center, so how you can retrieve, for example, cost center data from S4HANA using OData service. And then we wrap this call into the resilient command, into the Hystrix command, where you can also take a look at what is the actual motivation behind this resilience component Hystrix that we integrate into the SDK, and also our extension for this component with regard to caching. So this is also here in the step six. And later on, there are also very important topics that are asked quite often by our partners. And by our internal developments how you can actually ensure the security of your app, where we also introduce some concepts for both versions of the platform. And this tutorial will be extended especially for the GA, so we plan, as I mentioned in the tech, it will be generally available, and we plan to provide some more information here. So what else? So you've seen on the slide we have like several components, and maybe like the main value, or like the main value of the technical part of the SDK, is the S4HANA integration simplicity and the platform abstractions. I just quickly jump into the Java doc, which we also recently published for the SDK, so where maybe you can also get a little bit insight, like from the technical perspective, what's there. And this is exactly what you see. So for S4HANA integration component, you see a couple of packages here available for the OData communication, for the BAPI communication from the cloud platform, also for establishing the connectivity with S4HANA cloud or S4HANA on-premise. For the cloud platform part, as I mentioned, this is abstraction of the platform services that we provide, and the main things like tenant, user-related information, you can retrieve it a bit easier with the SDK. Also, you have abstraction for services like login, metering, and connectivity. Also, there are some adaption for the frameworks, for example, for Hystrix framework or for Eclipse Link for persistence. So you can also get a little bit inside what is exactly done here. And also, there are some additional packages, for example, with regard to quality, like testing, mocking, etc. So this is our Java doc that is also already there. Also, I encourage you, if you are interested, to take a look at the frequently asked question blog that we post here. And actually, you can also ask more more technical questions here. We will be happy to provide you more insight on the SDK directly in the community. Right, so let me just move forward. Now, what I would like to show now, so this was a very quick overview of the tool and what is actually currently available. And as I mentioned, for the GA, we plan to extend the documentation, we plan to extend the tooling, and stay tuned for this announcement on the ticket. But what I would like to do now is just on a simple, very simple example, I show how you can get started with the SDK and what kind of app can be quickly built with this. And also, as a next step, I just show the production app that we built, or like the app which is currently used already in production, which was also built on top of the SDK. So you also get a feeling a little bit what is possible. Right, so with regard to this simple app that I would like to show and explain, it's probably not of the big value, but it explains a little bit what components are there. It's the cost center controller app that allows to read the cost centers and write them back, basically. And this is very high-level architecture, how it looks like. So you have SAP Cloud Platform underneath, and you communicate with SAP S/4HANA to retrieve data and try data back, and you do this via OData or BAPI or SOAP protocol for writing. It's based on the Spring framework, and it exposes data via REST services, which are, on the other hand, consumed by UI5 application. So this is the idea. But first, before I move forward, let me try. Let me try to do this. Everybody hear me, yeah? Good. I do the following. So the first step that I would like to do here is just to introduce the Hello World application. So my very first step is how I actually get started. I just built my Hello World, firstly without any communication with SAP S/4HANA system. In order to start with the SDK, as I mentioned, currently it's in beta version. And if you would like to give it a try, you would need to download. You will get it as a zip archive, basically, and which you will install locally and install it in your Maven local repository. We also introduce a special installation script that will make it easier. Later, when it is generally available, it will be published in Maven Central. And basically, all the installation will happen automatically when you introduce your dependencies in corresponding Maven configuration file. Who have ever worked with Maven? Okay, good. So yeah, this is a component or the technical tool that allows to build your Java application. So basically compile all components from different sources, external components and your internal components, and build your jar basically that can run on the platform. So in SDK, we actually use Maven as a build tool. And you can also use Maven in your application to reference the SDK in order to include the SDK as a component. So let me just quickly show how easy it is to get started. What I have here, I've already installed the SDK locally in my Maven local repository. And what I can do now, so let me say I want to create new project based on SDK. Maven has simple commands, like you can generate the project using this command. And I just know that I can generate the project from the archetype. Archetype is kind of the blueprint of the project, or like stub project. And we introduce actually several archetypes in our SDK as well. For example, we introduce archetype for the Spring Boot framework that can then later run on Cloud Foundry with Tommy, with Tomcat, and also the archetype for Neo. So I will use one of them. So MVN clean MVN archetype generate, and then I want to use my local Maven repository. So what I'm doing now, I'm telling the Maven that I would like to go to my local Maven repository without referencing external Maven Central. And in this case, it will look up all the project blueprints that are available locally in my Maven. So let's see what happens. Right, so I have a choice now. I have four project templates that I can choose from, as we all of them are introduced in my SDK. So one of them will be the Neo-based project. So if I would like to deploy my project later on Neo platform, I would choose this one. And three of them are for Cloud Foundry, for different runtime environment, for Tommy, Tomcat, and Spring. So I will go with Tommy, for example. So I just choose the option two here with this project template. And after a few seconds, if the network is still there, because it's downloading also some dependencies for my project, the first Hello World project will be generated. And then we can take a look at this. So all the steps are actually described in the tutorials that I just referenced. So this Hello World example is actually the step two and step three of the tutorial that you can take a look. So when I generate the project from the blueprint, now I have to enter some information that is related to my project, and this is necessary for Maven. For example, group ID, that will be something that basically later used as a package name. So for example, this is com my company or com SAP or com whatever. In this case, the artifact ID will be the name of my artifact, and I will use it Cloud Foundry application, for example. I agree with the version, so this is standard Maven attributes that normally you always have to fill when you create your Maven project. So I agree with the default value here, snapshot version. Yeah. So yeah, I agree with the default version. For the Cloud Foundry, you also have to specify an additional parameter unique host name, which is later used in the URL of your running application. And here I will use Cloud Foundry app with my I number in SAP so that nobody else takes this host name. That's now generated. Let me just do the following. Now, in order to deploy this application, this Hello World application in Cloud Foundry, I need to build the jar or the var file first. And to do this, I just navigate to Hello World. Navigate to my application folder. and I use the Maven Clean Install option to build the charm. It will probably take a couple of seconds to build the char file that will later be deployed on Cloud Foundry. After it downloads some dependencies and builds the project, it should be quite fast, so I think we can quickly wait for this. Just to give you a little bit the reference again, that I'm not talking, so to say, out of the blue. We have this description, so you can also look it up afterwards if something is not completely clear. In the step 3 of the tutorial, where we describe basically how to build your Hello World application first. So it takes some time. So what it's doing now, so the project that I'm building, it contains a couple of components that are currently not located in my local Maven repository. And it needs to look up some components in the Maven Central, so it downloads some dependencies, for example, for cloud platform components or for S/4HANA components, and builds the char together. Okay, it's still building, so let me just quickly also in parallel open the just created Maven project, so we can in parallel also take a look at the structure. As you saw, I created the application in the Hello World folder, and the POM file is actually the main Maven configuration file that is used for referencing the dependencies and stuff like this. So I'm actually surprised that it's so long. Not good. So I just upload the just generated project into my IDE. I use IntelliJ for the development, and here we can easily take a look what kind of structure the project has. It's built. For now, I just quickly deploy it, and after that we take a look at the structure. So after I executed this Maven clean install, what I got here, I got this char file created out of my source classes that were there. And exactly this char file I would like to push to the cloud platform now to make it run, to make it callable. So what I do for this, I just actually say Cloud Foundry push. And if I'm still logged in, I hope so, it will push the file to the Cloud Foundry. It looks fine. While it's pushing the char file to the cloud platform, we can take a look quickly at the structure. So this is the project that was generated with the comment I just executed, Maven archetype generate that you saw before. It creates this project structure. And this project structure is predefined in our blueprint project in the SDK, so one of the blueprint projects that we provide. As you can see, we in the structure, we actually split the application itself from integration tests and unit tests, so you have immediately the integration test folder also here as an additional component. So we do this actually in order to avoid like deploying of a big component to the cloud platform, so to separate the tests and the logic itself. So you don't need to run all the integration tests while you are building the file. Then all the components are actually referenced here in the parent POM. So this is exactly what I meant here. This is the main configuration file for Maven. So if you haven't worked with Maven, this is the first thing you probably have to look at, like how this POM structure should be organized to build your Java projects together. Each of these components, so you can see that our project that was generated consists of basically these three components. One is the application, which contains the application logic, hello world logic. Then we have unit test and integration test. In the application logic, as a separate module, you also have a separate POM file, which actually declares additional dependencies to external components. And in the context of the SDK, the following components are of the main importance. So this Cloud Foundry, SAP Cloud Foundry and SAP S/4HANA components are coming from the SDK. And when you declare the dependency to these components here, you can actually use classes of the SDK in your development, so which I can also show you later. So this is the configuration file for Maven, where you say what you would like to use. So the main logic of this Hello World app is actually quite trivial. So we have this Hello World servlet, so this simple JAX-RS application, which can respond to get method to this URL. So the URL of application slash hello, and it returns after that Hello World. So this is basically a very simple Hello World Java EE application that we have in this template. So now when we have this deployed, I can show how it works. So we have this application built, and you can, after you push the app to the Cloud Foundry, you can get immediately the URL where the application is accessible. So I can go to this URL now and see what happens. Oops, this is wrong. This is the wrong one, so this one. Sorry, it was the wrong one. So I go to this one because another window was for the other application. So this is where I built the Cloud Foundry Hello World application. I take this URL and go to this URL. So now it doesn't work exactly how it was expected. So who can tell me what should I change here in order to make it work? You read. That's right, because it's just actually mapped to exactly this URL and a hello world. So this is just the first step, how you basically introduce your very, very first Cloud Foundry application with Java. Basically, I just did three simple things, or four simple things. Let me just repeat. The first one, I installed the SDK in my Maven local repository. It's the step. This step is required only for this current beta version of the SDK. With the GA, it will be automatically downloaded from Maven Central. The second step that I did was generating of my project from the archetype. This is simply done with the Maven command Maven archetype generate. It creates the project from the template that is introduced in the SDK, and it creates exactly this project that we just saw. Here. So this very simple application integration test unit test structure with the stub classes like Hello World and Hello World integration test. The third step that I did was the building of char file that will be later deployed on the Cloud Foundry. Okay, I have not that much time, not expected. That was built in the Cloud Foundry, exactly. So Maven clean install is another command that can be used to build a char. And afterwards, I pushed this char into Cloud Foundry with the help of cfpush, the special command that you get when you install corresponding Cloud Foundry tools. All the steps I explained in our tutorial, so just go ahead and try it out. It should be quite simple to start with. What you can do afterwards, that's maybe more exciting. Like you can, it's this freestyle, what I was talking about before, right? So you can do many things. You can integrate your S/4HANA system by for example, communicating with S/4HANA with OData and exposing this result, like using this servlet approach also. You can also take another framework, another project template. For example, if you're feeling like more familiar with Spring Boot framework, with a Spring environment, you can also take another project template from SDK and use a little bit different Java technology for this. So what I can also tell here, I actually wanted to show you how you can also build more complex app like this cost center app here. It's not very beautiful, but you still can learn many interesting additional patterns of SDK here. For example, just very quickly, there's probably the next complexity step in the SDK. In addition to the hello world logic, we introduce here two additional methods, basically, which can post cost center, so when you create the cost center, and read cost center. So for these two steps, you just basically write three additional lines of code that allow you to call the OData service for reading the cost center and executing this query. And like in two lines of code, you can basically communicate with BAPI to write cost center back. For this, of course, you need to learn a little bit how the SDK Java API work, so what particular methods you need to call, but it's quite simple when it's clear. So using this, you can kind of build this kind of example app. And by the way, this source code that I just showed here, we plan to publish it in GitHub, so this will be available for your reference. One more thing, just to finish with, some example of the production app that is actually built on top of the SDK. This application called SAP RealSpan, which is actually used by some customers already live. So this is also a very good example how you can integrate the S4HANA logic and S4HANA data model with your additional logic and additional data model in the cloud. So for example, here, this is the application for a cost center manager who wants to compare the plan data, plan costs, with the actual costs by some dimensions like account, cost center, internal order, etc. So we can see already here that some master data is coming from S4HANA directly, like account, cost center, internal order, maybe well-known terms if you work with S4HANA or ERP system for a long time. But there are some additional dimensions which are introduced on top, so to say. And this introduction was done actually in the cloud platform directly with some SDK components. For example, something like tasks or product ranges. This is the dimensions that can be created here in the app, and they will be stored in the cloud platform. Important to mention that this cloud application don't need to replicate the data from the S4HANA in the cloud. You can also potentially read this data on the fly, communicating with OData services, maybe caching for some time, as the cache mechanism is there as well. So yeah, I think I don't have time anymore. And I think for questions also, but feel free.
Because we're running a bit of a late, right. Have some Q&A at the bar.
Exactly. So I'm happy to, if you have some questions, happy to answer them and also to exchange experience on this cloud development topic. We're happy to do this. Thank you for your attention.